Hey, this is Peter Neptune. You're watching HospitaliTV.
Woohoo! Hey guys, welcome back to another episode of HospitaliTV. Thank you so much for your time and thanks for watching or listening if you're on the podcast. Today we have Master Sommelier Peter Neptune. We're in the middle of SommCon. They were gracious enough to get us a quick room so that I could interview him. So it's all coming together quick, but we're super glad to be here. There's a tremendous energy around the Marriott Hotel and there's a lot of great things going on this week. So first and foremost, Mr. Neptune, thank you so much for being here.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Thanks for taking the time. I know it was very last minute, so I appreciate you giving me this window of time.
Able to pull it off.
Yes, we sure did. Here we are. You know, as with most interviews, I like to kind of have the origin story and to see a little bit where, how you got into the business of wine. Obviously, we'll get into a little bit where you are now in that business, but it's such an intriguing story, and I just wonder if you'd share it with us how you originally got into wine.
Well, I'm from California, and I went back to New York, or I went to New York to go to school, and got a job. You know, you're talking about working at the Addison and hanging around and
yes.
asking for a job. But basically, I did the same thing. I got hired at a restaurant as a runner, and worked my way up to captain pretty quick.
Okay.
And you know, this was the early '80s. This was late '70s, early '80s, and things were just starting to turn in terms of the world of wine. And I got kind of bit by the wine thing. It's New York City. There was a society back there called Les Amis du Vin, the Friends of Wine. And it was like probably a version of like Chaine de Rotisserie out here mm-hmm. or something. This guy came in and he was always talking about wine. He loved Alsace wine. So I had he brought in a bottle. It was the first time I ever had like an Alsace Riesling. So, oh my God. And then a guy brought in a bottle to the restaurant. This is probably 1981. He brought in a bottle of 61 Opréon.
Oh my God.
Chateau Opréon. Legendary wine.
Mm-hmm.
And he gave me a taste. And I literally, it was
That was it.
Yeah. And you're like, you're kidding me. This is real? So I started reading and kind of studying, and I didn't even know there was such a thing as the Court of Master Somme back then.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, this was before Fred Dame had even passed. So it was that was a British thing.
Was Fred Dame in New York at the time?
No, I believe he was out here in Monterey at the sardine factory.
Right? Oh, that's right. Were there any working Sommes that you knew of in the city at the time?
I didn't even know any.
Yeah.
I mean, there was Windows in the World.
Okay.
And Kevin Zraley. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I had gone to like one or two of his classes.
Oh, so he was already doing that.
If my memory serves me right.
Okay, so he was kind of like the guy who stood out
kind
in the
of,
scene at that
time.
Kind of,
yeah, okay. yeah, yeah. Although now, you know, my sense of time, this is a long time ago. Mm-hmm. This is 35 years ago. But I just got bit by the bug, and I talked the restaurant owner into kind of letting me work on the wine program at no extra charge, right? And just started tasting and started just, you know, you just start getting into it. And then when I moved back to California in 1990, I got a job working for a wholesale company, carrying a bag and work in the street. And by then, you know, there's the Court of Master Sommelier,
sure.
So I began taking exams and studying and doing all that.
And you had left New York kind of as a server or captain with a decent
amount of
wine knowledge.
I was working floor somm
yeah,
at
okay.
the time.
Okay.
And came back out here and moved to Laguna Beach, where I'm from, and got a job carrying a bag. And with the ultimate goal in the back of my mind, my background is in theater in New York.
Mm-hmm.
And I had done Broadway and off-Broadway and national television commercials. And I came back out to L.A. originally for pilot season and to do some TV shows. And I shot some episodic television. And for many reasons left show business. It's a tough biz. And
imagine.
The only thing I knew anything about was wine.
Right.
I mean, and of course, I knew this much, but I thought I knew that much.
Yeah. Do you think working the floor as a server with a passion for wine and engaging people, did that give you the upper hand as far as like the acting part of your career? And or
I think
are they just two completely different beasts?
No, I think that I think working the floor is a kind of theater, for sure. And I can tell you without any hesitation whatsoever, my theater background absolutely helped my when I became an educator. It is absolutely linked with how I present, because I present it as kind of theater.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing is you know, memorizing plays, memorizing scripts. I'm really good at memorizing things.
Yeah.
And that really helped because I was disciplined already in how to memorize.
Yes.
And how to implant things physically in your body so that when it came time to do the MS theory, which is oral, the biggest thing that you see that candidates have a hard time with is you know that they know the information, but they can't bring it up right then under the pressure of the situation. And then all of a sudden you go down the rabbit hole because we move on to the next question and you're still thinking about the question two questions ago.
Right.
You're done.
Right.
And so being able to recall information, being able to recall, and I mean physically, and there's a way to put things physically in your body so that you can recall them immediately. I mean, there's a technique for that.
How do you do that?
You handwrite everything cursive. So I would write a play. I would literally copy a play in handwriting on yellow legal pads.
Mm-hmm.
That's how you never ever forget something.
And I would imagine that you don't normally write in handwriting in cursive.
No.
So is it just by forcing yourself to do this different?
It's a physical.
Yep.
It's the physical process of going back to fourth grade Catholic school when you had to do cursive, and writing it out. And so you're forcing your body to do something that you haven't done for a long time. And that physical act of both writing it out and writing it in cursive, and a professor of mine taught me that.
That's fantastic. Yeah. All right, now I get to go home and rewrite all my cards. That's amazing.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're back in California,
mm-hmm.
And you have this new job. At what point did you jump into
education?
Yeah,
I carried a bag for a couple of years, and then I had an opportunity to go to work at a startup company called Paradise Beverages. And I literally had this opportunity to go from being literally a sales rep to a VP of sales running a wine division. And I just thought, holy moly, I can skip middle management entirely and go to work for this startup. So I drove to LA every day to downtown, like bad downtown LA, and worked. I mean, I left Laguna at 4 a.m. and I got home at 10 p.m. And I did this for about 2 years. And the company ultimately went out of business. It was a startup and it didn't work. Mm-hmm. But I learned how to do everything from run a sales force to import to pricing to, I mean, I was like a one-man show.
Mm-hmm.
And I was tired of it. It was a lot of hard work. But
I bet.
Yeah. But it was great for discipline. But that gave me the impetus. You know, I really want to focus on education. I was now working on taking my advanced SOM exam.
Okay.
And it's like study. So I literally had no time to myself. I was working and studying.
Right.
And I just thought I need to somehow get into education. And a guy named Fred Reno, who was the president of Henry Wine Group at the time, had just become the president. This is 98. And he had heard of me. Somehow we crossed paths. And he hired me to be the director of education because he really put his money where his mouth was. Henry was a pretty small company at the time,
mm-hmm.
but he felt that the added edge that it could have would be education. And he hired me full time to be the wine educator and put together an education program for the company.
Wow.
And I remained there for 20 years.
Yeah.
He moved on and I remained for 20 years and then moved on. My school is my primary focus and consulting and things like that. But
so I have a couple questions about that too. So when you moved into the distribution company, at what point, so it's 20 years, it's a fairly large part of your career.
Yeah.
At what point, and I want to ask you about that as well, I want to ask you about that, but at what point in that career span did you decide to open the school
of
wine that you have?
So I was studying I passed my advanced SOM,
mm-hmm.
now studying to be an MS.
Okay.
And I had heard about this thing called the Wine and Spirit Education Trust mm-hmm. from a London-based organization that's worldwide. As you well know, they're mm-hmm. a sponsor here at SommCon.
Right.
And I actually, you know, back then it was a little more loosey-goosey. I contacted WSET because there were no APPs, approved program providers, out here on the West Coast.
Got it.
It was really only New York, I believe, at the time. So I contacted WCG London, and I said, I'd like to enroll in this diploma program that you have. I'd like to take the exam. Because, yes, you know, here I'm studying to be an MS. I think I know everything.
Right, and you want to prove it.
And I want to prove it. And I had already taken, you know, the MS exam like three times or four times, and had passed theory and service, but couldn't get past tasting. And I thought, well, you know, there's this other credential, WSET diploma. Mm-hmm. Let's go for that. You know, probably more than anything, you know, am I worthy? Like, can I pass a freaking test?
Right.
So I contacted them, and they said, well, you can't take the diploma exam unless you pass the level three exam. So I said, well, can you just send me that and I'll take it? And they said, well, you have to have someone invigilate it. And I said, well, so a buddy of mine was a teacher at Laguna Beach High School. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, can I have him, can you send him the exam and have him give it to me? And they said, yeah, we'll do that. You know, so I took the exam, level three, passed it. And they said, well, now you can take the diploma exam. And I said, well, listen, you know, I'd just like to take the exam. You know, I'm already studying to be an MS.
Right.
I mean, my theory's pretty good.
Right.
I passed MS theory already once.
Right.
So I flew to New York and took the diploma exam. And I remember I had to fly there. Back then, you flew there 1 year and took half of it, and then you flew there a year later and took the other half of it.
Okay.
So I passed the WSET diploma, and in doing that, I contacted them again and said, hey, I'd like to open up a school here on the West Coast. How do I do that? So you go through a lot of rigmarole,
yep.
But ultimately, I opened my school I passed my diploma in 01, and I opened Neptune School of Wine in 03. And I originally taught on the weekends.
Okay.
So, you know, I worked my job Monday through Friday,
yeah,
and taught on the weekends. And then I started expanding by, I usually was doing home office work on Monday anyway, so I began teaching Monday nights and Saturdays. And then I had other, a colleague teach Wednesdays, for mm-hmm. example, and Thursdays. And so that's how we got started. And we originally were in a small space at Laguna Culinary Arts in Laguna Beach.
Okay.
And then about 5 years ago, we moved to our current location in Costa Mesa, where there's a dedicated classroom,
yep,
just for the school. And,
right.
And, you know, it's pretty amazing.
Wow, that's, yeah, so interesting.
Yeah.
I mean, you hear so much about the school.
Yeah.
Right? Like, there's a lot of really good, you know, feedback from everyone who's kind of gone through the program.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I have so many questions about the school and, you know, how it got created, especially after doing, you know, you're going through already a lengthy process with the wine distribution company, and you passed your MS now, and you're in a position to teach.
Yeah.
One of my first questions is, how do you attract people? How did you attract people to come to the school? Is it,
yeah,
basically, you know, the power of association of, you know, I am a Master Sommelier,
right,
come to our school, or,
yeah,
how did you initially attract people to come to it?
Yeah, that's a great question.
And what troubles did you have, if any?
Yeah, well, we started small. We started with low expectations, and my colleague, Nancy Milby, who owns LCA, which was Laguna Culinary Arts at the time, you know, she had a kind of walk-in customer. She had a small wine shop. She had a cheese shop. They had a cooking school. So there was a little bit, and then, you know, a mailing list slowly grew.
Uh-huh.
So you had people on the mailing list. And we would do classes, and we'd have 15 people and be happy with that.
Yeah.
And I would do level two, and I'd have 15 people, and then I'd start level three.
Right.
And I didn't start diploma until sometime later. And it takes a lot to,
yeah,
get approved as a diploma provider,
mm-hmm,
a lot.
Really?
Yeah, okay. WSET puts you through a lot.
Okay.
A lot of screening process and a lot of paperwork and this and that. But we just started small, and what you find is that there's a lot of people who are started at level one or level two, and you have home chefs, you have people who are a lawyer who wants to be better at entertaining, wants,
right,
to know to go to your restaurant and look at the wine list and be able to order a white burgundy or,
right,
something. People who just want to learn more, and then people who maybe wanted to get into the wine business for a career. And,
yeah,
and that, this phenomenon of getting credentials really, I think, started, I was right there when it started to turn. Just more and more people wanting to get some kind of a certificate.
Mm-hmm.
And the level two, you get a lot of people doing level two. It's 8 weeks. You know, 8 classes, it's $900, it's doable.
Mm-hmm.
And you get a whole base of that then feeds into level three.
Right.
and then enough of a base at level three to feed into diploma, because diploma is hardcore. I mean, you might get out of a 25 level three, you might get three people who want to go on to diploma. Mm-hmm. So it just kind of snowballed, and we have a mailing list for Neptune School of Wine, and we have a mailing list. I mean, obviously I'm on the internet. I have a Wikipedia page. You know, I was approached by a Wikipedia writer who saw me give a lecture slash tasting 5 years ago and said, you know, I can get you on Wikipedia, right? Yeah. And so when you Google me, I mean, that comes up. Neptune School of Wine comes up second.
Yep.
And I think people just, you know, Wine Education, Orange County, my website comes up.
Yeah.
A lot of word of mouth.
Sure.
And thankfully, you know, I've developed a really good reputation in the industry as a lecturing Master Somm and, mm-hmm. and examining Master Somm. You kind of have contact with up and coming people.
Right. And you know, one of the reasons I ask you, so there's a couple different reasons, but one of the main ones, is that, you know, we do a lot of education right now in the restaurants, right? And I'm sure you've been in that position too, where, you know, not everybody comes to wine class,
right? Yeah, that's okay.
That's something I used to get upset about it, you know? Like, why aren't people coming?
Yeah.
I'm putting so much work into this. We have a guest speaker, you know, we have maps, we have what do you want?
Yeah.
And people just aren't going to come. And then you learn to be okay with that.
Yeah.
And you focus on the people that do come.
Right.
And now I'm like, listen, if one guy's coming, I'm going to sit down with you, we're going to talk, and I'm excited about it.
Yeah.
And it like makes me less angry, right?
Sure.
But that's I think it's part of the process, but I guess where I'm going with that is, you know, at what point do you, how difficult was it for you to kind of get past that point of not having people come, and then finally kind of maybe a tipping point to where people are actually interested in coming to you?
Well, we've just been, you know, knock wood, we've been great, because we'll have level twos now that have 18, 20, 25 people.
Yeah.
And my current level three class has 27 people in it. And that's a lot of people.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a big class. Perhaps too big.
Yeah.
But we don't seem to have a problem filling the classes now. And again, it's all the you got to have a base of level two to feed into level three, and level three and level four.
What, or maybe having like a more introductory level to attract people.
Yeah.
And then
But what's fascinating to me is that, and this is maybe a little off topic, or
no, please.
But what blows my mind is there is a small percentage of people who just don't show up for exams.
After going through the whole thing,
and I'm talking diploma students where the exams, like a Unit 5 or Unit 6 exam, I give once a year.
Right.
And they've taken the course, they've paid for the exam in advance, because the course includes the fee of the, I've registered them, and once you register with London, if I registered your name, you're registered.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's no dog ate my homework.
Right.
You're registered, you don't get a refund. And I just gave diploma exams last week. And I had 3, 4, 5 people out of 18, 19 who just didn't show up.
Do you think he's got spooked before the test? You put so much work into it.
Sure. I think that I think there's a generation of people, do you know who I'm talking about, mm-hmm. that got a medal for showing up.
Mm-hmm.
And they are afraid of failure because mm-hmm. they've never, ever failed.
Yeah.
And first of all, failing an exam or not passing an exam is not failure.
Sure.
Right?
Right.
You didn't pass an exam. I mean, I took the MS exam 6 times. Okay.
Wow.
It's not failure. It's a learning experience. Sometimes you need to take an exam to figure out, what do I need to know here?
Right.
How is this thing going to go down? Oh, those are the kind of questions they ask.
Right.
And it's just there's a group of people who I think are afraid of getting, oh wow, I didn't pass, because they've never ever not passed anything.
Right.
They always got a medal for showing up, and just my personal opinion that's not how life works.
Yeah, no, certainly not.
You know,
it's just a shame that you would put that much work in it out of your own time and money and
effort,
and not at least
give it
a
swing. But people generally show up to class. I mean,
right.
I make the classes fun. We taste really good wines. And here's what's also really funny is WST level 3, there is a blind tasting section of the exam.
Yeah.
And I'll almost say that 100% of the students pass that section of the exam because they've been with me for 12 weeks,
right.
tasting 6 wines a night.
Right.
And I just tell them, you got to just, You're tasting with me. If I tell you something is high acidity, mark it. Right. It's high acidity. So you know, come across wine. Okay, this is high tannin, high acid. That's your model. Don't ever forget. So they've learned to become pretty good tasters. Mm-hmm. Theory, I can't follow them around and make them study 15 minutes a day.
Right.
I can't do that. So what's fascinating is that I generally churn out pretty good tasters.
Yeah.
But about half the people don't pass the theory exam because they don't put in the time.
Right.
They don't put in the work.
And you can't shove it down their throats.
I can't. Yeah.
Right.
I lecture for 3 hours on a Monday night.
Yeah.
But a lot of my stuff, as I tell them, I'm not the college professor who just opens up the study material and reads it to you.
Yeah.
A lot of my stuff is anecdotal.
Yep.
Stories of walking Hermitage and walking up to the hut that, you know, that he built. Von Sturmberg, right? Or what's that guy's name? Gaspar.
Oh, Gaspar, yeah.
You know,
Sturmberg. I was there 3 weeks ago.
No way.
I was just there.
At Hermitage?
Literally a trip of my lifetime, yep.
Oh, isn't it great?
It's unbelievable.
Did you climb up the hill?
Yep, we sure did. There was nobody there.
No, yeah.
There's no one
it's
there.
It's awesome.
And the vineyards were immaculate.
Yeah, you're in Dionier or in Hermite, you know, the little tiny Loudy. And you know, this hectare of land is worth how many million dollars, and there's no
right.
one there.
Not one person.
And
I thought we were going to have to sneak by somebody.
Or,
no. I mean, we just went right
up. And then you get
up
to the Hermite, to the little chapel, and you looked at, and there's the Rhone stretching below.
I have the best pictures.
It's the best.
Yeah. Oh, so beautiful.
It's so great.
So I wanted to ask you something else as well, because I think that I'm wondering if you have two different approaches in the way that you approach a level 2, maybe 3, maybe the diploma, right, with people who have become maybe hobbyists. I'm sure you have those type of people, like you said. And then you have the people that are actually looking to take higher level certifications, right? There's those types of people. And then going back to your days working for the distribution company, how do you approach the education there with a sales team of professionals?
Yeah, that's a great question. My approach was, you know, Fred Reno, who hired me, said, look, I want you to educate people about the world of wine. Now, if you can tie our products into it, or, you know, or use our products as an illustration, that's fine. But I really want you to educate people about the world of wine. So it's a slightly different approach than a approach that many distributors have now, where it's really just kind of a top-down model of here's wine education vis-a-vis our brand.
Mm-hmm.
Again, it's fine, but it's vertically integrated, and in my opinion, it's not holistic.
Right.
So that being said, what I developed was a wine education curriculum, which was pretty detailed, and I wrote a curriculum. In fact, I could probably turn it into a book.
Because can you do that, please?
It's all written.
Yeah.
Now that I think about it, it's all written.
Yeah.
I wrote a curriculum, and I would I literally broke it into kind of a 2-year, because you know you have these meetings every month, a 2-year rotating curriculum where we're going to start at Alsace, and Savoie it was Alsace actually. Maybe I included Savoie in the lecture. Then the next month, it's Italy Northwest.
Mm-hmm.
Then the next month, it's Germany.
Okay.
Then the next month, it's Austria and Hungary and Switzerland.
Mm-hmm.
Then the next, I mean, and we didn't sell any at the time, any Austrian, any Hungarian, and any Swiss wine.
Right.
But it was just this curriculum, and then I would have an exam I would have quizzes every month, and then at the end of the year, an exam, and it was called the Neptune Award for excellence in wine education, and it was a very difficult exam, and we took the winners for the first few years to French Laundry.
Wow.
And they got the Neptune Award, it's framed, and so it was a culture of wine education and an essential wine education of the wines of the world.
Mm-hmm.
Illustrated again, if we're talking about Australia and we're at the Barossa, you know, we might pour, or certainly did pour, one of the wines that happens to be in our book from the Barossa.
Mm-hmm.
But in no way, shape, or form did we ignore any wine growing area just because we didn't sell wine from that area.
Right.
Because my feeling, and Fred's at the time, was that, well, that doesn't mean we never will sell wine from that area, and our people need to be prepared.
Right.
And that's how we went to suppliers, and that's how we approached suppliers as one of the competitive advantages. of the company is that we have the best educated sales staff in the world. And I believe that that was so.
And what's the follow-up there? Because when you have the School of Wine, obviously you have, you know, rigorous testing, and you kind of either pass or not, like what we were saying.
Yeah.
Like there's a, you pass or you didn't.
Yeah.
Whereas with the sales team, it's not like you're going to fire one of the guys.
Right.
Didn't really come
through.
How do you keep them engaged there?
That's a great question. We, you know, fortunately, you know, we just had a culture. It was an entire culture. People would come to work for the company because they wanted to be educated by me, frankly.
Right.
And that reputation just got out there. I mean, you know, salespeople talk, and they're standing in line to wait to call on you.
Right.
And they go, you know, how's it going? You know, where who do you work for? Oh, you know, how's it going? Oh, you know, oh right. Man, I'm getting beat up, man. I got to make my quota of, you know, private reserve Chardonnay or whatever. And you know, how are you doing? Oh man, we're great. I just got educated last Friday on Austrian wine. We don't even sell Austrian wine. Really? What? Yeah, we got Peter Neptune, and you know, it just starts to get out there, and it's like, well, geez, I want to work for your company.
Yeah.
And I think that word of mouth is, you know, that's how a movie's a hit movie, because of word of mouth.
Yeah.
You know, you can do all the marketing in the world, but if you have, when you begin to develop a reputation, it starts to get out there.
Yeah.
And so, and then that fed into the school, and you had people, you know, who but there was just, it was a culture of excellence, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And I have always demanded a lot of myself, and I think I demanded a lot of our people. And so it just, you didn't have a lot of slackers.
Yeah.
You know, and in a culture like that, people tend to drop out if they're not keeping up.
Right. That makes sense.
Yeah.
So I have another question for you revolving around how people kind of receive education. How do you see it changing now in this, you know, in this era that we're in, where everybody's glued to their phone, everybody has access to information.
Yeah.
Right? That's the biggest thing, like where you normally would have to go to the library or do research or find a map.
Well,
you have it all on your phone right now. How do you think it's going to change the way that people educate or, you know, receive education?
I have very firm opinions on this, and I'm going to sound like a Luddite. and people are going to think I'm old. I learned from the Sotheby's Encyclopedia of Wine, the Oxford Companion of Wine. I would highlight that. I am a firm... I don't think that you can learn from this thing.
Yeah.
I think all the information's there, but I'm seeing average scores go down. And in my WSET classes, and this is a bone of contention with London and me, is they contact me regarding exam results. And the theory portions, the passing scores are going down.
Really?
And I absolutely attribute it to ADD.
Attention span, yep.
No question.
Mm-hmm.
I drove down here, took me an hour and a half to get here, and nearly every car I passed was going 50 in the fast lane, and they were on their phone.
Yep.
Driving.
Super dangerous, super crazy.
It's a nightmare.
Yeah, it's insane.
I don't believe that you can learn from a thing like this. Mm-hmm. I absolutely don't believe it. I'm a firm believer, and you're going to come to my panel just a half hour here at SommCon. and it's how to study for these things.
Yeah.
And I'll tell, you'll hear me repeat it, but I believe you have to write things out longhand.
Yeah.
You have to trace maps that we are not hardwired to, you know, we have evolved over a million years, and this technology is only 10, 20 years old.
Yeah.
I think it's perhaps the worst thing that's happened to young people trying to study, probably in college, trying to study to become PhDs in something, trying to become Master Somms. I just don't think that's the way to do it.
Yeah.
And I can back it up with more than anecdotal evidence.
Yeah.
Because my passing scores are diminishing.
And yeah.
And I don't think there's any substitute, especially learning out of taste, for anecdotal evidence from somebody who's walked Hermitage, who can paint a picture of it, and I also think that anybody studying the world of wine has to go to these places, has to walk the vineyards, has to touch the dirt, and then the memorization necessary. It's hard work, and and I don't think you can learn it off a little device.
There's not a substitute for it.
No.
No, I agree. I mean, I think it is going to get interesting when, like, VR kicks in, and, like, if I can kind of believe I'm in Hermitage by sitting here in a conference room at the Marriott.
That would be awesome.
That's going to be a trip.
That'll be a trip.
But I 100% agree that you can't, even if there were, like, a little hologram of Peter Neptune coming out of here that was giving us a wine class, that is not the same as sitting in a room with you.
Yeah,
and really, because I 100% agree with you. And honestly, one of the best wine professors I ever had was the ISG in Las Vegas when I lived there for about 9 months. This guy, Wayne Gotts, he's still the man. I think he was the vice president at the time. He taught us very few facts, and he was 100% about the story.
Yeah.
He was a historian at heart.
Yeah.
And everything that he talked to wine about, it was about the region and the people.
Yeah.
And I'd never had somebody deliver information like that.
Yeah, that's how I teach. There's no substitute for that. Yeah.
Peter, I could talk to you all day.
Yeah.
You're super interesting. I can't thank you enough for the time. Honestly, especially for someone who's kind of trying to find the best ways to educate their own staff. I have like a million questions for you.
Yeah.
But I'm going to end with one.
Sure.
We're in SommCon right now. Mm-hmm. You know, what's your favorite part about it? What are you most excited about right now?
This is my first year here, believe it or not. I've done TechSom for many years now.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And you know, it's great to see old friends. I mean, I ran into Mark Valen downstairs. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's great to see old friends that you just haven't seen in a long time.
Yeah.
I'm going to sit in on a couple of panels where I can. To me, it's always interesting to hear other people speak and to see how they educate. Some are really good, some aren't. I'm looking forward to the two panels that I'm doing, the one today and the one on Friday. And, you know, it's just... I'll be able to talk to you better after a couple days here, but I'm looking forward to it.
Well, I'm looking forward to it, too. Thank you so much for your time.
My pleasure.
I really appreciate it.
Thanks.
Guys, thank you so much again for watching HospitaliTV. Make sure to check out Neptune School of Wine. If you're in California, in Southern California, just drive by there, check it out. Check out the website. A lot of really cool things on there. As always, don't forget to follow us on Facebook and Instagram at HospitaliTV and on iTunes Podcast, HospitaliTV on there, too. Check us out. Thank you so much.